Hi all, this is Kevin from UX Reactive. Priyanka, I think, has some connection issues. She just told me. Prasad, I think we can start off if you're okay with it.
Cool. Thanks, guys. Quick question. Are all of you students of me or somebody from, are there non-students as well here?
So is there anybody in the call who's a faculty or somebody?
I think you guys need to unmute yourself. If you're speaking, you need to unmute yourself because we can't hear anybody here. So just, is everybody a student here? Not getting an answer. Yes, hi. Okay, maybe a better way might be you can just put in your chat messages so I can see, you know, in case if you want to type in instead of saying anything, you can just type it in so I can see. So that might be easier. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, perfect. Cool. So I'm going to start then. Perfect. So we will just use this as a chatting mechanism because maybe if everybody spoke, it might get a little bit busy. And I have a few slides which will require people to contribute and talk about stuff. So I'm going to do a very quick introduction, right? I am one of the founding members of UX Reactor. In my past, I've worked with Yahoo and eBay and Honeywell and a bunch of other companies out in the US. This is technically my first tour of duty in India in terms of professionally working. So it's interesting. It's been an interesting journey for the last 6 years. And one of the things I'm very passionate about is really sharing, what I know about design, because I think design is really the future and where it's going to require a lot of creativity and a lot of discipline to kind of, you know, make India a design country. So I think, I'm very passionate about that and I'm really excited to share what I know with all of you folks. Please feel free to share, ask any questions at any point. I will try to answer as much as I can. And with that said, I'm going to get going. I'm going to start. If you cannot hear me or anything, so just, message Kiran and then Kiran will have his chat window open. So he can just basically tell me to stop and, fix whatever the problem. Sounds good?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Cool. Thank you. So, is everybody able to see my screen?
Yes,
sir. Let's see.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to see
my screen? Yes, sir.
Perfect. Cool. Thank you, guys. Thank you for giving me the verbal feedback back because it's very whether you know the internet is bad or whatever. So why? On all of these images, right? So the first image here that we have is an aircraft cockpit, right? The second is actually Google search. The third is automated car. The fourth is you know the space control center for ISRO, and the fifth is a thermostat called Nest. Okay, so what do you think is common between all of these? So feel free to chat, type in your stuff so I can look at the answers. Let's see. Okay. What do you think is common amongst all of these images? Anybody?
Can you please repeat what was the like? What was
the picture? Are you able to see the picture?
Can understand clearly
on your screen. Okay, so this one, first one is an aircraft cockpit. Okay, the second one is Google search. The third one is an autonomous car. The fourth one is a space center and a space control center at ISRO. And then the fifth one is a thermostat. Okay, so what is common amongst all of these? Anybody? I'm gonna just let's see. Oh, you don't see the picture. Are you able to see the picture now?
Yes, sir.
Let me just 1 second stop presenting. I'm going to cut my video feed so it's easier, and then I'm going to share my screen. Okay, so what is common amongst all of these images? Any answers? I'm going to wait for about 10 seconds and I'll give the answer. In case somebody wants to contribute, please feel free right now.
Energy? I mean, like internet can be the, like electricity can be a form of energy. So you know, it all required energy to work.
That's true, but that's a very general answer. We need to look for a more specific answer. Right. So, you know, I see one which says, you know, it's the layout, but it's actually not the layout or the energy, right? If you think about it, each one of those is an incredibly complex software system, right? This aircraft by itself has like maybe hundreds of sensors, right? It's probably run by, you know, a few 20, 30, 40 computers simultaneously running, controlling different parts, right? And at the end of the day, this is this little joystick that controls everything, right? So when you think about it, it's an incredibly complex software, piece of software and hardware that is controlled by an individual, right? And the cost of mistakes is catastrophic, because if the pilot makes a mistake, you're talking about 250 people's lives in the hand, right? The other thing when you think about is Google, right? What is very interesting is it found 23 million results in 0.41 seconds, right? If you think about it, if you want to understand, in the 0.41 seconds when you typed in restaurants in Hyderabad, some software kind of basically figured, listen, this guy is looking for Hyderabad, so I need to only find results within the Hyderabad area, right? And then it went to go into like maybe there's probably a few 100,000 computers somewhere in Singapore that were decided, okay, you are the closest computer, so you're going to answer this question. And then this computer basically went through like a few billion websites to come up with those 23 million answers, right? Out of those 23 million answers, there's another software that actually decided this is the order in which everything has to be, so that the person who's going to look at it is going to find it valuable, right? So all of this was done in 0.41 seconds. Again, you're talking about incredible complexity, right? So as far as the user is concerned, they just go type in the box. You don't think about the complexity that happens behind, but all of that happened, right? The third image when you're talking about it is an automated car, right? In this car, you know, this is again, it's got so much intelligence and so much brains. It's actually got radars, LIDARs. It's actually figuring out whether the object in front of it is a car, a dog, a human being. That is figuring out what kind of strategy it should use if somebody is going to come into the way, right? There are a lot of things that are going on in order to make sure that somebody is going from point A to point B safely without touching the steering wheel, right? Again, you know, incredible amounts of data, and some of this data is coming online from online, some of this data is coming offline because the car is also planning its route based on what is happening in real time. So, you know, based on all the other cars, this is talking to a bunch of other cars and saying, okay, do you have a traffic somewhere? So based on that, I will avoid that route and go somewhere else, right? All of this is happening. The fourth image is ISRO, right? You're talking about, you know, a satellite that is probably going maybe like 40, 50 times the speed of sound around Earth. And any mistake could be very dangerous. And there are probably like a few 100,000 objects in space. So the satellite has to navigate all of those objects and still safely transmit information back, right? The fourth one is Nest, right? Which is a thermostat. This thermostat is helping you, you know, change the temperature in your house. But more importantly, what this thermostat is doing is it's actually your personal energy broker. So what it's doing is in the morning, when everybody's using electricity, it's actually saying, okay, I'm going to use my inverter and I'm going to discharge all my electricity from there so I don't have to pay more money. In the afternoon, it is charging your batteries, right? And in some cases, when it has excess electricity, it's actually selling it back to the grid. So in essence, just by installing this, it's actually earning you money because it is, if you're not using energy at the peak time, it's actually selling the energy. And then during non-peak times, it is buying the energy, right? So each one of these products is incredibly complex, right? You're talking each one of these products is also in a $1 trillion product range, right? So automotive sector is $1 trillion. Search and internet is a multi-trillion dollar business, right? And search is the beginning of everything, right? Mm-hmm. Internet and space work, right? It's also $1 trillion worth of business, right? The airline industry, again, $1 trillion industry, right? Each one of these are dealing with incredible complexity, but as far as a human being is concerned, it's very, very simple, right? And so the simplicity usually comes from designers, right? It is the designer that's actually taking all of this complexity and simplifying it and giving it back to a human being, right? So it comes down to this, right? So when you say, what is user experience design, right? And user experience design, if you think about it, is essentially understanding what a user needs or wants, what is possible from a technology perspective, and how, where can you make money, right? If you can understand each of these three components, then you can actually deliver user experience, right? And so that is where you are residing. So for a lot of designers, it might actually come as a little bit of a surprise because most designers that I interact with will tell me that, you know, sir, I am doing design because I like art or because I like, colors, layouts, whatever, right? But the point is that's not true, right? A designer can be anybody, right? That is anybody that is connecting the user needs to the technology with the business goal is a designer, right? You're solving problems. So the way we define designers, a UX designer is somebody who's solving technological problem, right? And creating experiences for the person who's using your product, okay? So any questions or thoughts? If you have any questions or thoughts, every couple of minutes, I will basically look at the chat, or Kiran, if you see any chat messages in there, just inform me. And then I will stop. But you know, feel free to ask questions in the chat box, and then I will stop at that point. Okay?
Yeah.
Cool. So now this is the interesting part, right? So they say, well, user experience is a high demand skill for software companies. Like, you know, and so what they did was, this was way back in, I think, 2013 when this experiment was run, where they said, you know, if everybody is saying user experience is a differentiator and it's going to create billions of dollars of profit, really, let's actually look at what money has it made, right? And interestingly enough, what happens is, they basically did the S&P, which is the Standard and Poor Index, where you said, okay, there are about 100 stocks or whatever. I'm going to invest $10,000 into the S&P index. And at the same time, I'm going to create this other group of companies, which I know are all design-centric. Right? These are design-centric companies, and I'm going to invest $10,000 in design-centric organizations. Not surprisingly, right? Design-centric companies, in a matter of 10 years, right, gave almost $40,000 in return for $10,000. That means it converted every dollar into $4, right? Whereas in the regular market, a dollar just barely converted into $1.70, right? So you can literally see that there is a 228% increase just because companies are design-centric, right? And so this is not surprising. So now if you notice, if you go to Harvard or Stanford, or you go to, you know, University of Michigan or any of these top business schools, most of these MBA degree giving schools, the top schools, also have a design curriculum for their MBA students, right? Because all of these business schools have realized, unless people learn design and learn to design for the user experience, you will not make profits. And even companies are turning around saying, you know, this is really important. So what is interesting is, 20 years ago, a designer was just somebody who could do graphics, right? Today, designers are directly reporting to the CEO. So there's a title called the Chief Experience Officer, right? In most of these companies, these chief experience officers report directly to the CEO, right? In fact, in Apple, for the longest time, Jonathan Ives, who was the chief designer, was reporting directly to the CEO, and he was basically one of the three people who was making decisions on what products to launch and what products to not launch, right? So in the last literally like 15, 16 years, design has gone from becoming just a graphic design, you know, exercise, all the way to somebody who's actually driving business decisions and actually creating value for stockholders, as well as creating market opportunities for the product, right? So any questions or thoughts at this point? Kiran, are you tracking?
Yes, Prasad. I don't see any questions so far.
Perfect. Okay. So here are all these other companies, right? So this is Workday, eBay, Uber, ServiceNow, Facebook. You need, right? Each of the top 500 companies in the world, all of these guys have designed, right? Now, within India, there's a Times of India article that came out, I don't remember, maybe about 4 or 5 years ago, which said, you know, designers earn 150% more than engineers. So, you know, comparatively, a good designer will actually always earn more than an engineer, for one simple reason. Is designers, if an engineer fails, you just have to rewrite the code, right? Whereas if a designer fails, you actually have to, you know, you've lost millions of dollars because the designer's done something, the engineers have coded it, and then you realize you failed, you've wasted a lot of money, right? So companies are actually investing significantly in actually bringing in top design talent. And for them, money is not a question, because if you're going to get the right design, it's going to save you millions of dollars. And it's going to get you huge opportunities, right? If you get the wrong designer, you're not going to get the opportunity, nor are you going to be able to make profits or compete in the market, right? And so this is something that all of these companies have basically said, we have design as our center, right? And without design, it's not going to work. So here's a question, right? So if you're a designer and you have a dustbin here, and the design problem that you have is you want more people to throw stuff in the dustbin, right? How would you design the dustbin so people throw stuff in the dustbin? Any ideas, any answers? Just keep typing it in and we can look at it. So the question is, if a designer was given the problem of creating a dustbin where people would throw stuff inside the dustbin, how would you design it? Okay. Please type in your answers, at least 5. How would you design a dustbin? That's the answer. Okay, perfect. So Kunal is basically saying, you know, a dustbin should be very easy to see. So it is visible. So people know, okay, there is a dustbin and I'm going to throw it. So that's good. So you're solving a visibility problem. Excellent. Anybody else? I need four more answers. Interesting. So you're basically saying I'll create a target so it becomes more interesting. So people will actually want to throw stuff into the target. Create a target so people will throw it. Okay. So you want to make the mouth a lot easier, because if you make it wider or bigger, then people will be able to throw it a little bit easier without having to bend. Okay. Make it more funny. So get people's attention, right? Make it simple, attractive and creative, right, Sanket? We will make it interactive so people will involve and enjoy the process by some feedback maybe, right? So I'm going to play this video and it's got some audio, so you can, you know, if you can, if you cannot hear it, let me know. But for now, I think I'm assuming everybody's, it's going to be easy. Oh, sorry. Give me a second. Okay. That's a very interesting way of solving the problem, right? So what it has done is it's basically addressed the fact that people are very curious, right? And when people get curious, they are going to basically pay attention to it. They're, you know, they're going to want to use it a lot more, right? And during the process of curiosity, it's also that discovery, right? So how many of you similarly have actually, you know, seen what Google does, Google Chrome does when your internet is not working? Do any of you remember that? What does Google do when the internet is not working?
That dinosaur game that appears.
Yeah, the dinosaur game appears, right? So was everybody able to see the video? Because some people say they could not see the video. Was the video visible?
Yes.
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir, it wasn't visible.
Okay, I tell you what.
No, sir.
I will share the link to the video. Right? In the URL, you guys can watch it. I'll give you like a couple of minutes. Okay? It's in the chat box. So you can watch the video.
Okay, sir.
Hey, is that Nitin from Deloitte?
Yes, sir.
Dude, how are you doing?
I'm doing good. I just joined, dropped by to see you. How is it going?
Cool. Nice meeting. So yeah. So guys, you can watch the video, and then when you're done, just say yes, done, and then I'll give you 2 minutes, and then we'll continue on with the video discussion. Everybody seen it? Perfect. So the point being is, when you look at this, right? So the designer is basically understanding the psychology of the human being, right? And they're saying curiosity is one of the main things that a person reacts to. And you're basically creating a solution that addresses the curiosity of the individual, right? Not just that. Now, when you're making people curious, they talk to other people about it, right? And that is what engages people. That's exactly the same thing that Google did, right? When Google Chrome is not connected to the internet, right? It'll give you a dinosaur game. When you see the dinosaur game, you actually talk to other friends like, hey, did you try this game? What happened, right? So now it creates this opportunity for discovery. It is a joyful moment, right? And that is how designers basically look at a problem and they try to solve it with their deep understanding of how a human being's needs, what a person's needs are, and how you can solve those needs. Okay? So now the next question that I have is, this is another video that I want you to see. This video is probably a few, this is another few minutes, right? I want you to look at this video because this video is really important because it's telling you where the future of design is going to go, right? So here's a video. You can watch this. I'm going to give you about a minute, so you don't have to watch it for more than a minute. No, it's not the screen, but you can click on the video. Click on the video link. I sent it in the text box. So what this video is basically showing is that software is actually getting really smart, right? All you have to show is you just draw a screen with like basic colors, like anybody can actually do basic colors or draw boxes or whatever. And the software is going to try and figure out what you want. And it's creating different scenarios, scenes, and all of that in real time, right? So when you do that, all of a sudden, now historically as designers, we've thought like, you know, creativity or, you know, color combinations and all of that is really important. But then here is a software that's already doing it for us, right? So the question that I want you to think about is like, if software is already creating such rich and visually live images automatically, then what would a designer do, right? Because it's doing your work for you. Right?
Yes,
so that's one question I want you to answer, right? And I'm going to send you another video, right? This one video is interesting because what it does, let me just see. I'm just sending you another text message. Right? Click on this video, and what this video is doing is something mind-blowing, right? Once you've seen it, then tell me you've seen it. Just say that it's done, and then I will tell you, we'll talk a little bit more about it. Perfect. What did you guys think about this video? right? Because I know a lot of you have to learn HTML and CSS, or you think coding is difficult, right? A lot of you have learned Photoshop because you think Photoshop is where it's going to be. So the previous video showed like how software is going to automate everything. And this video is showing like how code is going to be done. Somebody literally draws a box and all the code is going to be done. Now imagine if both those pieces of software work together, it will automatically do your colors, layouts, visuals, everything will be done. So what will a designer do? What is the job of a designer in that situation? Right? Any ideas or answers for that? I'm looking for at least three answers here. And you can speak out if you want, because nobody else is, I think this is an open line. So you can speak if you want, or you can type it in. So one of the answers, the designer's job will be determining the program of the software. What does that mean? Is it like what software to use? Is that what it means? Context, okay? Jamie says context, right? What will the software do, right? Exactly, right? So you guys have named it, right? A designer is now basically solving problems. So what is interesting is Photoshop is a tool, right? Programming is a tool, right? What all of these automation softwares are doing is it is allowing you to get rid of the tools. It is doing all of this on an automated basis. So you no longer have to worry about tools. Now you can worry about the context, about the human being that you're solving the problem for, and how the problem will be solved by the software. Those are the questions you answer, not how you design a screen or what colors to put and how to do it, right? And that is a very, very dramatic change. And by the way, these demos, these videos that I've shared with you have already been in the market for almost a year or 2 years, right? So this technology is already coming. Okay, so one answer is designers will help them to develop in a more creative way. And till the users find the answer, need to engage your users. Exactly. So designers are primarily focused on the users. They're not focused on software, right? So that's one of the first lessons or thoughts that you need to take with yourself is when you create your resume, right? Are you creating your resume saying, these are the problems I've solved? Are you creating the resume saying, I know Photoshop, I know Adobe, I know Figma, I know all of that, right? Because if you know Figma and all of that, that is not important, right? For a designer of the future, what is more important is, are you able to understand your customer? Are you able to solve the problem? And are you able to tell the software what context it should work in? So that's a huge, huge difference, right? So now when we go back to the presentation, I'm going to go back to sharing my deck. Resume presentation. Okay, perfect. So now you understand, right? So now here's a question. So if you were the person who's basically solve problems, right? The question here is, here's a sign up, right? Can you innovate on this sign up form and create a $4 billion opportunity? How can you create a $4 billion opportunity, right? And so the interesting thing here was, there's one company that did it, and pretty much all of you use that product. So before, you know, you used to have Google Chat and Yahoo Messenger and all of these, where what you'd have to do is you'd have to fill in like 20 different form fields, and then you hit enter, and then you basically start logging in, and then you have to ask everybody, what is your user ID so I can add you and then connect to you, right? But all of a sudden, this little company basically called WhatsApp comes along, and it says, listen, why should you even have a login? You don't need a login. What I'm going to do is I'm going to send an SMS to your telephone number, because only one person will have one telephone number at any point in time. And I only need to recognize who that individual is, right? And so it says, I'm going to send an SMS to your telephone number, and then I'm going to check it. And literally all your contacts are automatically added. And literally they went from 0 to 100 million users in, I think, a year and a half time, right? And that company basically got purchased for $4 billion, right? Just for solving the login problem. Right. So when you think about from a design perspective, right, everything is an experience. People actually, the experience of creating an account, the experience of, you know, getting your friends onto that account is very painful. This company identified that pain point, solved it, and created an opportunity for $4 billion. right? And that is what a designer does, right? That is an example of how you can create context, right? So now when you think about stages of a career in design, you think there are basically three stages, right? There's CX, UX, and UI, right? UI is the lowest level of a career, right? And so when you actually put your resume saying, I am a UI UX designer, it does not give you any respect from people that...
But sir, sorry to interrupt, there's a question from Sanket, I guess.
Okay.
So he's asking why software workers are doing designer's job.
So could you explain a little bit, Sanket? Maybe you can just speak out and then I can understand you better.
I mean that the work of designer are doing their software designer, softwares are doing their job.
Uh-huh.
Why means they are interrupting or that software part of designing.
So, okay, why is software doing a designer's job? Is that what you're asking?
Yes.
Okay. See, the simple thing is today, right? At least maybe not today, but last year, IBM had a requirement for 4,500 designers in its Austin location, right? They're not able to find the designers, qualified designers. The problem is not people who have degrees, but people who can get the work done, right? It is very, very hard to find competent designers, right? Even at UX Reactor, right? We go through, I think we have gone through about 45,000 applications to select about 70 odd people, right? And each of these 70 people, we train again, whether they get designed or not, we train again, right? So the biggest problem in the market is we are not able to find designers who can get the job done, right?
Okay.
If you find designers who can get the job done, then I have to create software that will automate it for me. Otherwise, it is very, very hard to do it, right? I have to allow, if I can only hire two designers instead of four, then I need to create software that will allow these two designers to do more to their work, right?
Okay, right.
So that is the reason why. So again, the point is it's not software is taking away. Fact is, we do not have enough designers who are capable of getting the work done, and that is why everybody is basically creating automation for that. It's an opportunity.
There are less designers.
Yes, then less competent designers, right? Designers who understand what need to be done.
Good high professional designer, they are not available, so they have changed it into softwares and make their work
exactly.
Okay, thank you.
Right,
sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So when you look at the career of a design, the lowest is UI, right? A UI person is literally only looking at, you know, how should I design my screen? What element should go where? So generally, you know, a software engineer will come or the engineering manager will come and say, this is the screen. Now make it look good. That's what the UI person does, right? The next level is UX, right? A UX person, basically somebody goes to a UX person and says, can you create an app for my bank where people can do banking online, right? So that is user experience. So this user experience person is either like handling a complete product experience where I'm either you're doing an app or I'm doing a desktop solution or I'm doing like mobile or whatever, right? So different kinds of solutions, they're focused on that and they're solving that problem, right? The highest level that you see is CX. CX means customer experience. Generally, CX people are people who are either the CEOs of their own companies or are reporting to the CEO, right? And these are people that are looking at customer experience. So what a CX person is going to look at is like, okay, so, you know, the classic example of a CX is, should there even be a login form, right? So that is what a CX person asks. The UX person says, this is the login form, I'm going to do it, right? So the CX, an example would be, let us say I'm going from here to Delhi and I need to create a 500 rupee demand draft, right? So I might actually, as a CX person, I might create a solution where on my desktop, I can say, okay, I want to add this person as a beneficiary. And then when I get to the airport, I can log into my mobile and say, okay, I'm going to the Dhola Kuan, area. So I want to go to the bank location in Dhola Kuan and I want to pick up a draft in this name and I'll put an order. And literally once I land in Delhi, I go to that bank branch, pick up my DD and walk away. Right? That is customer experience. So customer experience looks at customers. It does not look at whether you are doing something online, offline or whatever, right? So generally the career progression is it takes at least 10 to 12 years to become a customer experience professional, where you are actually leading the market and you're telling the company how to design its products and its strategies, right? At the below level, it is UX, right? So ideally, when you're doing your career, when you create your resume and you say, I know this tool, that means you're applying for UI level jobs. If you're saying I've created solutions for these and you're showing examples of that, like again, if you put in Behance images and stuff in Behance or Dribbble, right? Those are UI level solutions, right? UX level solutions are, you should be able to say, this is the problem I noticed. This is how I solved the problem. And this is my answer, right? So that is the UX level. So if your resume is able to communicate that, that means you are a UX person, right? And gradually, once you get enough experience as a UX person, you move into the CX level, okay? Any questions or thoughts at this level, at this point? So feel free to type, I'm gonna go on to the next one, right? So from a UX perspective, right? From a design perspective, what do we look at? So one of the biggest, you know, things, interesting things that I find is designers, at least, you know, the way we are educated is you have to do individual work, right? You're writing your exam alone, you're doing your projects by yourself and all that. But really, in the real world, a designer is actually working in teams, right? They're working with engineers, they're working with product managers, they're working with researchers. So it's a different group of people, right? Designers are always curious. Designers are actually looking at problems to identify solutions. So they're taking initiative, right? And designers are responsible for the product that they're creating. So they are very committed to what their solution is, right? And that is what are the common characteristics of any of the top designers you see in the world. These are the common characteristics that you would notice, right? So from an attitude perspective, it is very important to have this, because you could be an amazing designer in terms of sketching or art or whatever, but if you don't have it, it'll be very hard to create an amazing product, because, you know, at the end of it, it's not skill, it is skill plus attitude that makes a product great. All right. So what should you learn to become a designer, right? So there are components of research that you need to do. There's components of ideation, workflows, wireframes, visuals, right? And then there is also metrics, right? So there are different types of people. So again, in design, you know, the most common thing is, you know, only designers can become a designer is what the common thought is. But at UX Reactor, what is interesting is majority of our people are not designers, right? We have engineers, we have architects, right? We have artists, we have commerce graduates. So we have people from all kinds of backgrounds, and they all come in and basically try to solve the problem together, right? And I will tell you why these backgrounds are important. But again, for a successful design to work, it's important that you come from many different backgrounds and you kind of bring that knowledge together. Okay. Again, if you have questions, type it in and Kiran will stop me and then I will answer those questions. So what are the options, right? There are different career paths. So there are three main career paths. If somebody wants to start their career, there are three areas, right? The first area is a research area. The second is visual designer. The third is interaction designer, right? And then over time, as you get enough experience, then people become strategic designers, right? So what does a researcher do, right? A researcher basically looks at different kinds of techniques, right? So it could be something as quantitative, running surveys, or, you know, looking at click-through data or A-B tests and all of that, or big data, data analytics, to kind of figure out what that data means, right? So that is one, that's quantitative side. The other one is you're observing how people are working, right? So you are basically testing a product out and you're saying, okay, is the product working or not, right? The third one is you're actually going into people's homes. So there's ethnographic studies, which is the formative studies where people, you're trying to understand how people solve a problem in their day-to-day life, to, you know, you're taking a UI and giving it to somebody and saying, okay, now test it and tell me what you think about it, where you're failing. And then the last part is you're doing big data analytics or the quantitative stuff, and you're looking at all of these data, right? So this researcher is generally a combination of, you know, there are people that come that are good in, either come from sociology, anthropology, statistics, you know, psychology. So all of these backgrounds, people from these backgrounds do really, really well in research, right? So that is what we look at from a research persona. And these guys are very, very analytical. They will be able to look at a problem and break down all the issues that they're noticing, and then be able to convert that into requirements. So that is what the capability of a researcher is, right? Now, the second discipline is an interaction designer, right? Interaction designers basically look at the design from a very logical perspective. They say, okay, so from this page, where should you go, right? Okay, if in this page you get an error, how will you handle that error? Now, what are all the different technologies or integrations that you need to do? You need to integrate with email, SMS, tweets, or whatever. So how do you plan all of that? So these are the people that look at the very high level, right? And they're planning how the product will work at a very, very high level. So generally, this is the interaction designers will do the workflows. So this is an example of a workflow, right? Now, they will also do the layouts. So they will say, okay, what is the relative importance of different pieces of content, right? And they will put all that information together and they'll do a layout from a task perspective, right? And so the interaction designers generally tend to be very logically oriented. These are generally people that we have noticed is tend to be architects or engineers. They come from very, very, structured way of thinking, and they're very logical. And so they tend to be very, very successful as interaction designers, right? Now, the third discipline that you will see here is visual design, right? And this is most people will actually confuse UX design with visual design, but it's not. Visual design is a part of UX design, right? And so visual design is where somebody will come in and say, okay, I'm going to look at colors, layouts, I'm going to look at maybe animations, right? So those are all the things. So a visual designer is still capable to say, okay, I understand the logic that the interaction designer gave, but now I'm going to create an emotional component to it, right? So generally visual designers tend to come from, the visual arts, right? These are people that are more artistically oriented. They also tend to be more sensitive, right? Because they try to they understand what the other person is going through, because how can you create emotion or how can you communicate the emotion on a screen if you do not understand emotion yourself, right? So visual designers also tend to be intuitively, empathetic to what the people are saying or doing or whatever, right? So they tend to be a lot more in touch with their emotions. And so this is what a visual designer does, right? And by the way, if you haven't realized, this is the design process for Twitter. This is actually the key components that go for Twitter in terms of posting or how the homepage was done, right? And so you have these three specializations. Now, what is interesting is, as people get more and more experience, initially people will start their career, most likely will start as visual designers or interaction designers, with a minor in research. And as they get more and more experience, they become strategic designers, right? And what a strategic designer does is something very interesting, right? So they will look at all of this data and they'll say, okay, yeah, I understand that people want to carry their mobile phones, right? They want to carry their music with them. They want to carry a camera with them, right? So a UX guy is basically looking at saying, I want to create a better camera, or I want to create a better iPod, or I want to create a better phone. But the strategic designer or the CX person is actually saying, why don't we merge all of this and create the iPhone, right? And so that is where strategic design is actually looking at the larger picture, looking at larger trends and saying, what are the new opportunities and how do you strategically create new products and bring them to market, right? So that is what the strategic designer is looking at, all right? Any questions or thoughts so far? I just heard
there's a question.
Okay. So Kunal says, okay, we should understand. Okay, so there were two questions, I guess. So I'll answer both of them. So we should understand the need of the users, no, not the need to create more comms. So we should be able to give solution instead of just, okay, that was a comment. It's good. It's excellent, right? Understand the need of the user is what is more important. Now, Kunal's question is UX design only confined to digital media like creating apps and websites, or can it be applied to other design disciplines? Absolutely, right? See, design is a mindset, right? When you use design to design spaces, right? If somebody says, hey, I want you to redesign my bank, right? In terms of where people are waiting, how people go up to the counter, that's called service design. It's a specialization, right? Where people are looking at physical spaces and designing it is service design, right? The other one, when you're creating physical artifacts, like an iPhone or, like furniture or something like that, it's basically called industrial design, right? Where you are creating physical artifacts, right? So design as a philosophy is the same, but depending on where you choose to apply it, your specialization will be different, right? You actually have, interestingly, there are people that will design museums, right? So because when you go into a museum, you want people, it's like going into a museum is like watching a movie, right? Which room should you go to? Which painting will you see first? Which painting will you see second, right? So there's a sequence to watching things. So again, that's also a design component, right? So there's also different kinds of design. So in this case, I only gave you an example of visual design. But now when you think about artificial intelligence coming, you're having your mobile devices, right? So you can actually do sound design, audio design, right? You can do haptic design, because you know your devices vibrate, right? So you can actually be a specialization in how vibrations can communicate, so especially when you're like thinking about like fighter pilots, right? When they're flying a plane, right? They actually get haptic feedback that tells them, okay, there's a rocket that is launched at you or something like that, right? So there's a lot of different ways that you can give it. This doesn't have to be technology. As long as you're focused on your customer and you're solving problems, the digital component is UX design. But then if you're doing any other ones, it has a different name, but the process is the same. Does that answer your question, Kunal? Cool, perfect. Any other questions? All right. So I'm going to go back to the presentation. So here's an example of a project, right, that we worked on at UX Reactor. So this gentleman is Mr. R.K. Anand is a very accomplished and very recognized person. He was the founding member of Juniper Networks, which is the number one competitor for Cisco, right? It's on in the networking space. So he basically came to us and he said, we have this back of a napkin idea where we have a product, right? So one of the most interesting things is when you create automatic cars, the biggest challenge that you have with automatic cars is not in driving, it is in parking. Because when you want to park an automatic car somewhere, you need to know, okay, that parking spot, who owns the parking spot, right? Is it a municipality or is it some individual? Now, will the individual give you permission, right? If you're going to the municipality, how do you pay the municipal person, right? So there are a lot of legalities involved in parking a car. So what he said was, I want to create the technology for when automatic cars become legal, I want to create the technology so that these cars can go and park themselves, right? It's a brilliant idea. So they said, but the problem is, if I'm going to create all of these technologies, but then cars do not become legal, automatic cars do not become legal, then I've wasted a lot of money. So can you help me create a business model where, I can make money even before automatic cars come in, right? And then once automatic cars come in, I can literally switch the system, and then our cars will be able to park themselves, right? So we said, okay, so let's go solve it, right? So this is a design team. So we had a team of four people, right, who spent 16 weeks to analyze 165 different possible solutions, right? And then finally, we came up with two different ideas. And then out of that, we finalized one idea and we shipped it all within 16 weeks, right? So you're talking about 4 months. In 4 months, we went from a technology. Somebody just showed us the technology, from the technology all the way to an app, right? And then once this app was demoed to their customers, they were actually able to sign on Facebook as one of their first customers, right? So this was a simple example where we said, oh yeah, so what if we create like an Airbnb, right? Where I own a parking spot, I can say, my parking spot in the morning when I'm going to the office, nobody's using my parking spot. So I will give it to you for $2 an hour. And then in the evening when I'm coming back, I will increase the rate to $10 an hour. So if you want to pay $10, I will go park somewhere else, but then you can have that parking spot, right? So literally that's how the system worked. And we were able to kind of come up with all of these solutions, like how will the system work? How will the software work? How will the hardware work? Because once you put the hardware, how will the hardware detect a car? So literally all the way from installing the hardware to all the way for a car to go find a parking spot, we designed that whole experience in 16 weeks. And we prototyped it also. This is what a designer did. A designer prototyped everything so that all they had to do, they didn't have to do one single line of engineering or code. They just went in, showed the prototype to Facebook, and they said, okay, we are signing you on as our first customer, right? That is what happened, right? Now, the other thing to think about now is that's where this is the technical aspects of design, right? But now when you think about the more fun parts, right? Design is global. Today, there are not enough designers in the world, right? If you want good designers, right, for us at UX Reactor, right, we are desperate for talent. We want good designers wherever we can find them, right? So we have offices in, you know, San Francisco and Hyderabad, and we realized we have good designers in Colombia. So we opened an office in Colombia, in Medellin, right? So with design, you have the opportunity to be exposed to a global community of designers, right? The other thing is we solve cutting edge problems, right? All the way from medical devices, where somebody wants to put a hearing aid and then how to make the hearing aid work better for the customer, all the way to, you know, saying, how will I make, you know, have 32 million customers in the UK, use a telecommunication device. So that's Nokia. So what we're doing in the UK, in June, it's going to launch. But what we're doing there is we are actually using artificial intelligence to predict where a problem is going to happen before it happens and solve it before the problem even happens, right? So this is all through design, right? And so we are working in financial sector, in computer security. Our software is used by the US Navy. It's used by NASA, right? It's used by, telecommunications companies in the UK, around the world, right? We also, you know, this security software. So literally across the board, we work on amazing products and amazing problems, right? In fact, some of the companies that we work with are funded by Elon Musk, Airbus, General Motors, right? So it's a very, very unique opportunity. This is the time when if you become really good designers, right, you have the opportunity to work on some of the most interesting problems that anybody can find, right? Now, we compete globally too. So because design now with internet and everybody's access now as UX Reactor, we compete globally. In fact, you know, UX Reactor, we won the best UX design for 2019 as a Fast Company Award. And the other companies won the award were Samsung, IKEA, Google, Wall Street Journal, Adobe, and all these guys, right? So it doesn't matter if you're a big company or a small company. If you're good, you're good. You're going to get recognized, right? And that is something that you want to think about, is like, how do you compete? How do you create a global footprint? And how do people recognize you, right? And design can give you, if you're good at your work, it can give you a global audience where millions and millions of people will see your product, right? So any questions or thoughts so far?
No questions over, sir.
Cool. So I think I'm coming to the end of my slide. So one of the things that we at UX Reactor are doing is we are basically working to make sure that we have a global, in India, we can have global designers, right? So one of the things that we are opening up for pretty much any interested designer anywhere is basically say, you know, you can become a design ambassador, come join. We are creating a community where people can share and talk and kind of learn and discuss design at an international level, not just at, you know, a national level. So, you know, if you guys are interested, feel free to kind of, send us a message or whatever, and then we can onboard you as a design ambassador. I think that's it. So that's the end of my presentation. So if you have any questions or anything, I'd be happy to answer at this point.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Students, do you have any query? Students and the other crowd? Your presentation was quite informative. Thank you so much for being with us. And we would be definitely looking to collaborate with you further. We would be definitely looking to meet you further. Thank you, sir.
Cool. Thank you. It was really nice interacting with you guys. Best of luck.
Yeah. Thanks.
Chalo. Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.